Hey guys, so I'd like to share with you guys today some of the lessons that I've learned over the last 5 years. Can you hear me okay? I hate microphones, so. But I'm gonna start by sharing a story with you guys. So in July of 2012, my husband Andrew and I were stationed in Columbus, Mississippi at Columbus Air Force Base for his pilot training. In July, I was about 18 and a half weeks pregnant, and we were on our way to the anatomy scan when you find out if you're having a boy or a girl. We were so excited. Up to this point in my pregnancy, everything had been pretty normal, pretty routine. And so we went to this appointment. It was such a blessing. He was actually able to get off of work to go to every single appointment with me. And I didn't know why at first, because that's kind of abnormal. When you're in pilot training, you're usually pretty busy and you can't actually get off. But looking back, I can see why God had the commander he had to allow him to do this. So we went to my anatomy scan that day, super excited. We're going to find out if we're having a boy or we're having a girl. And we get there and I'm just amazed as they're doing the ultrasound at the movement, the way he's already jumping around and spinning around. And as she's doing the ultrasound, the tech pans down and I'm looking at like the heartbeat, but Andrew's looking for, is this a boy? Like, he is super excited. And so he's telling me, like, look, it's a boy, it's a boy. And so we found out he was a boy. That was what we thought that whole day was about. And so as she continues to do the ultrasound, she keeps kind of doing some measurements and remeasures things. And at that point, we thought, she's kind of been doing this for a while. It's kind of weird. And so we said, is everything okay? Are you worried about something? She goes, the doctor will be in to discuss your results. And I thought, results? What are you talking about? We just found out it's a boy. That's why we're here today. That's all we came to do. And so we went back to one of the rooms, and I can remember it like it was yesterday. I was sitting there on the exam table, and Andrew was sitting in one of the chairs, and my doctor was about to walk in. And you have to know this. I had such an amazing Christian OB who, whenever he came into the room, he was lighthearted. He would tell jokes. He'd talk to you about his family. One of the most amazing doctors I had ever had. And so he comes in, and instead of his typical lighthearted greeting, and he just walks in and he sits down and he looks at us and he said, there's some things I need to talk to you guys about today. He said, there are some things on the ultrasound we saw of concern. There's some spots in your baby's heart and some dilation in his brain. And this could mean several things. And he starts to list things ranging in severity to your baby's not surviving your pregnancy. And he kind of goes through the list to, or it could be nothing at all. I said, okay. And he said, but you have to make a choice. And I looked at him and I said, a choice? How do we choose how to treat it? You haven't even told us what it is yet. What are you talking about? And he said, no, you have to choose whether you're going to continue your pregnancy. I said, I what? I mean, at this point I was 23. I grew up in a church. I knew about abortion. I didn't know laws surrounding it. I didn't know much else other than just what it was. And so, with that, I just remember thinking to myself, really, is that what he's offering to me right now? And my husband, and I couldn't even talk. I remember just not even knowing what to say and how to respond. And Andrew being with me, why he was with me, he looked at the doctor, he said, no, this isn't a choice, this is our baby. What do we need to do next to figure out what's going on? So he said, I figured you'd say that, but I just had to tell you it was a choice. And he said, so these are the different things we could do. And so they offered us to be able to do all of these different types of testing. And so we finally got to the point with prayer. We figured, well, we'll do high-risk ultrasounds. We want to take a look at this, make sure he has the safest and most healthy delivery he can have. And so whatever is the least invasive to do that is what we'll do. And so just like here in Clovis, if you have anything high-risk, you're probably going to go to Lubbock. You're probably going to drive 2 hours. We were right at that Mississippi-Alabama border, and so we drove to Birmingham, Alabama, about a two-hour drive, and so we were going to be doing this once every month. And so the first step was to go, and we met with a genetics counselor. And I go back to, I was so naive and so excited. I thought, oh, this is going to be great. She's going to be so encouraging. And we get there, and we sit down, and this is before they do the ultrasound, and she said, And again, she went over all the things that could be wrong with our baby, all the genetic things that could be happening, all the possible outcomes. And she said, but you're young, so if you choose abortion, that's okay. You can have more kids. And we're like, that's not why we're here. We're just here to see what we need to do to make sure he has a healthy delivery. She said, okay, but you just need to know that. And that kind of pulled at me again, like, really? really? And I don't need to know that. Like, that's not what we're here for. But that was what we heard. And so then we went on to the ultrasounds. And over the next couple of months, we went, like I said, once a month to Birmingham, Alabama to do the ultrasounds. And again, Andrew was able to get off of work every single time. So we went, we had a date day. And it was such a sweet time because we really got to share with each other during that time and to be supportive and just to seek God together. But we would go and they would do the ultrasound each time. And the spots on the heart, they kind of chalked up to being calcium deposits. They said that wasn't super concerning. It happens. But the dilation in the brain was really concerning to them. It continued to grow over the next couple of months. So each appointment we went, they would measure the dilation and it would be bigger. So not only is pressure on a brain bad, but when it's a developing brain, they have a lot of concerns about that. So it got to where they called it hydrocephalus, and they told us the dilation at this point never goes down. So what we're going to need to do is you're going to meet with a neurosurgeon because you're going to need to have a C-section, and right after birth, he's going to need to get a shunt put in so that we can drain the fluid. And I just remember being so scared, thinking, "What surgery? Brain surgery? My baby? Like I'm not even holding him yet." And but that was our reality. And so we were going back, and you know, we were, like I said, living in Mississippi. All of our family's in Maryland, but our family was praying. Our church family. We got really close with everybody there, just like you do here. And I remember our pastor specifically, he would come and he'd pray with us. And one of the very last appointments I had before Noah was going to be delivered, they said, we were on our way again to our next appointment. And as we're going, Andrew goes, "You know, I'm not going to try to over-spiritualize this or whatever." He said, "But I just really feel like God's been pressing on my heart that not only is it going to be okay, but the dilation's going to be down." And he said, "I don't know, maybe I'm just crazy and I'm just really hopeful." He said, "But I just really think that's from God." I said, "Okay, I hope so. Let's go and find out." And so we're there, and you know, the ultrasound tech's doing the ultrasound again, and she kind of just kind of keeps doing it, keep measuring, and she's, "Huh, interesting." We're like, "Yeah." And there's, "Oh, well, I can't tell you. You gotta wait till the doctor comes in." So we're like, "Okay." So the doctor comes in, and again, and so he actually repeats the ultrasound, and he keeps going over his brain, and he keeps doing measurements, and he said, "Well, this is interesting. I said, can you tell us? What's going on? What's interesting?" He said, "Well, we didn't want to say anything, but it looks like the dilation's back down to almost a normal level. And we've never seen this happen before. This doesn't happen. It doesn't." And in that time, to see God's healing hand at work was what we needed to continue just to put our entire trust and faith that he had his hand on the situation. He knew what was going on. He knew every aspect of this. So then the doctor looked at us and said, "Well, we can change our plan. You don't need to have a C-section. He doesn't need a shunt. What we'll do is we're going to induce you. You can try for a natural delivery, and we'll have you here. We'll induce you early so his head's not as big as it would be at 40 weeks, and we'll have a NICU here in case you need it." I said, "Whoa, that's a whole lot different than what you just told me was safe for my baby." He said, no, this will be okay. So the plan was that they were going to induce me at 37 weeks. Well, Noah actually ended up coming on his own early. And so, like I said, with us living in Mississippi, I had a normal checkup. And that night before, I hadn't slept well. Didn't think much of it other than, you know, well, I have my appointment. I'll let them know what's going on. Well, I was in active labor, beginning stages, so I didn't know. And so they said to me, you know, I was 35 weeks, 6 days. And they said, "Yeah, you know, we're going to need to send you to Birmingham." I said, "Okay, well, I'm going to go home and get my bag packed," because I didn't pack a bag yet. Everyone says, "Your baby's come late if it's first-time mom." I didn't pack my bags. And so the doctor said, "No, you're not leaving. You're not leaving. You're going to get an ambulance ride. Your husband can go pack your bag." That's a whole nother story, but so on we did, and I got a two-hour ambulance ride to Birmingham, Alabama. And Noah came on his own, 36 weeks on the dot. He was 6 pounds, 7 ounces, 19 and 3/4 inches long. He was the biggest baby in their NICU. So he was pretty healthy. He was in the NICU for several days. And so on day 5, we knew they were doing some testing with everything going on during my pregnancy. So we knew they were doing that. Day 5, it was a teaching hospital, Birmingham. And so the med students had come in and they were doing the rounds for the day and they were discussing different results of different testing that came back. And we were sitting there and we overheard them say trisomy 21 positive. And we thought, what? Were they gonna tell us this? This is kind of a big deal. Is that what it means? Like what they just said? And And it did, and the doctor came in a little bit later and he said, I am so sorry, that's how you just found out. He said, I hadn't even briefed, the results came back. So how are you guys doing with that? I said, well, I mean, it's hard to know that Noah may face things in life that we don't have to. We don't know what that'll look like, but we know that God still has a plan and a purpose for his life. There's a promise of that in the Bible. And he's like, so you're doing okay? Said, yeah, we're doing okay. And you know, again, I think he thought we were young and naive and had no idea what trisomy 21 Down syndrome could mean for him. So not only was there that, him thinking we were young and naive, but we had a little bit of a cultural barrier. So as we're engaging this conversation, he kind of starts to say, well, you know, there are a lot of things he probably won't ever do. And he started to tell me all these things that he thought Noah would never accomplish. And then these things, if he does them, it'll be delayed. And he kind of kept going on and on about that. And we were like, okay, but you're not God, you don't know. You know, we were told his dilation wouldn't go away, and it did. And I think he was really confused that we had hope. You know, and I also think he was just confused that we actually weren't devastated, because he said to us, he said, you know, you're doing okay. I would have been devastated if any of my kids were born like that. And I thought, really? And at the end of the conversation, when we were talking, you know, when we were talking about all of that, it just hit me that we had hope in that situation. Like, we had Christ. We knew that God still had a plan and a purpose, no matter what any diagnosis was. But what about those who don't? What would they have done? You know, and so if you know me, you know I'm a researcher, and I will research something to death. And so I went home, and I had already done research on all the different things that could have been the results throughout my pregnancy. But I came to learn that 9 out of 10 babies with Down syndrome are aborted. And God kept breaking my heart. So every time I kept learning something new. God kept breaking my heart a little bit more. And I thought, why is that? Why is it? And it's because of fear. Because we have a fear of the unknown. We have fear of something that's not maybe perfect or within our plan, what we think it needs to be. But what hit me, my father-in-law made this statement to me, and he told me, he said, you know, if somebody wants a perfect kid, they shouldn't have kids. Because no kid's perfect. They're going to disappoint you. They're going to frustrate you. He said, you know, we just can't do that. And so through all of that, my mom also came to the NICU while we were there. And she was there the day we got his diagnosis. And I remember her saying something along the lines to me of, you know what? We're going to love him the same. It doesn't matter. And I didn't know how much I needed to hear that in the moment. And I didn't know how much I needed that reassurance that they were going to love him just the same. But I did. And I had a lot of fears. And I don't think I recognized all of them within that situation when I was in it, but I did. And I don't usually share this part of my story when I talk about this, but so that was one of my fears. And the other fears that kind of started to arise as we went on this journey was, what if others don't love him and accept him the way we do? You know, it's hard in our society because there are a lot of things we don't know about. And the fear drives us in those situations. And then I also had the fear, what if I'm not a good enough mom? What if I can't actually give him what he needs? What does he need? I don't know. You know? And through that, though, was a time that I had to learn how to kind of take off that mask and share those fears. Because when Andrew and I took Noah home, we were driving home from the hospital. And if you know him, he is a rock. He is very level-headed. He is my rock. And he, as we're driving, he started to get upset. And I was like, so what's going on? Like, you know, why are you upset? And he shared with me how he was mad at God. Like, why did God give him an extra chromosome that might cause him issues in life and cause him to have struggles that we don't? Why couldn't he have done something for, like, to me, or like had me have a challenge? And he was mad at God. And it was amazing, though, that him sharing that with me allowed our relationship to grow closer to each other. And God knows our anger, God knows our fears, but we often don't take those to him. We think that we don't need to. But that was a time that God showed me, within those fears, you can share them and you can grow closer to God through that. Our words carry a lot of weight. And that's another thing that God started to teach me through that. Right after I had Noah, I had lunch with a friend who we had lunch throughout my pregnancy. She kind of knew all the things that were going on, the possibilities. And we sat down, and we were at Chick-fil-A, and I remember holding Noah in my arms. And throughout our conversation, it just kind of came up, and she said, "So, do you plan on having more kids?" I thought, "Well, yeah. I mean, if God gives us more kids, why?" And she said, "Well, you know, statistically, you have a chance of having more kids with Down syndrome." You know, she didn't want to say it. I said, "Okay, yeah, no, I still do. But that planted this little seed of fear and doubt in my head, like, well, I know I do. Does Andrew? And I was afraid to talk to him about that for a little bit. I was afraid to let him know of this fear of, like, what does he think? Is he mad at me? Where's he at in all this? And so one day he came home from work, and he came, and I was just bawling. I mean, I was not always super emotional, but after you have a baby, I'm sure some of you can attest, it's a very emotional time. And I'm just bawling, and he's kind of like, "Okay, what's going on? Tell me what's going on." And I was like, "Do you still want to have babies with me?" He's like, "What? What are you talking about?" He's like, "We have a 2-week-old. Like, you want another?" I'm like, no. I'm like, but really, like, do you still want to have babies with me?" He's like, "What are you talking about? Where did this come from?" And I said, "Well, what if our other babies are born with an extra chromosome?" He said, "Then they're born with an extra chromosome." I said, "Yeah, but what if?" He said, "Then that's the way God made them. That's okay. This is, God knows. Like, this wasn't a surprise to him, Carla. It wasn't like he was like, oops, added a little extra. Like, he knew. But if I didn't share that fear with him and take off that mask, I would have let that separate us. You know, I would have held on to that fear without letting him know what was going on. And I'm really good at that. I'm good at not sharing my fears with people, and I'm good at not sharing those things. But God kind of convicts me on that. And so throughout this entire thing, as we grew and saw Noah grow, we started to look at what is success in God's eyes. Because this doctor that gave us the diagnosis, clearly success to him was going to college and having a good job and the worldly things that we get caught up in. And so what is success according to God? So Matthew 22:37, I'm going to open it up really quick. This is what it reads. So a Pharisee was asking Jesus what the greatest commandment was. And in this, Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself." And it hit me. Success in life, what I've always thought success in life, is completely different than what God says success in life is. Success in life is loving God and loving others, engaging with God and engaging with others. Kind of what we're learning today, right? And so then I started to reevaluate what my idea of that was and how that played into my idea of what perfection was and striving for perfection. And my ideas were completely different than God's, I can tell you that. And so in my office, if you ever come to my office, you should, you'll see a frame, and this is what it says. It says, "I will hold myself to a standard of grace, not perfection." And I have this framed in my office because my whole life has always been more about doing the right thing, making a perfect choice, making things perfect. And I can get caught up in that really easily. But when I strive for perfection, I'm not living, searching for Christ in that. I'm searching for what I can do in my own strength, and I'm relying on myself. But when I'm striving for excellence, I'm relying on his grace to cover when I fail. And I'm able to better love others that way too. And so this framed art, when I bought it, it was really neat because the lady who creates this, she shared with us on her website what the purpose was behind it. And so 2 Corinthians 12, nine to 10 says, "But he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, and in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong.'" I don't usually delight in weaknesses or in failure, but we can. We can delight. We can say, "It is well with my soul because of what he's done." And so this really started to kind of pull at me. I needed to focus on grace, not perfection. I needed to strive for excellence so I could show grace and receive that same grace. It was funny, I was talking to Jenny the other day, and she was saying how someone had said how I had it all together. And I laughed because I said, they don't see me at home. But how much more than we see somebody that has it all together, do we need to extend that grace to them and remind them of that? Because when we're able to extend grace and receive grace, we can take that mask off with each other, because we're not looking for perfection. We're looking to encourage one another and to grow in deeper fellowship. And so it, just like in marriage, it lets you grow together with God. It lets you grow in intimacy with Him. Same with each of us. And so the biggest thing I learned that I always share with my story was that I learned how judgmental I had been growing up. So my response before my experience with Noah, if somebody had talked to me about abortion, I wouldn't have responded out of compassion and love. Because to me, abortion was always a black and white issue. I knew what it did to a baby, but I didn't know what it did to a woman. I didn't know how it affected a family. I didn't know any of that. I didn't know how it was presented to women. I didn't know the impact it could have, the pressures to choose it, sometimes even the threats. So I didn't understand any of that. And have you ever heard the phrase, ignorance is bliss? I think we've all heard that. Definitely wasn't in this case, because my ignorance of not knowing any of that and not having dug into that truth of what the other side looked like probably hurt people with the words I said. And our words have a lot of impact. And so through my experience, God stirred my heart, He convicted me, and He called me. And this is just the beginning of how God led me to be part of the PRC. And so throughout the PRC, being at the PRC, and some of the training that we do, we learn about and get to have a deeper conviction of how we can see other people in God's eyes. So how can we love them? How can we engage with them? And so this is one of my favorite things that they teach, is that we don't have to question whether someone is worthy of our time or His love and compassion, because Christ decided that on the cross. The ground is level at the foot of the cross. If you've ever looked at a picture of Calvary Hill, right, and you see the three crosses, I often just picture it being this gigantic, steep, very pointed hill. But this kind of reimagined in my head what that looks like. Like we're all the same when we come to Christ. His love for the next person is the same, no matter what choice. His forgiveness, His grace, it's the same. And so I share that because being within the PRC, we get the opportunity to counsel with women and to talk with them, to walk through with them. But if I hadn't gone through what I did, I wouldn't have known any of this, and I wouldn't have known how to share Christ's love and forgiveness, to tell them about the healing He offers. And so so now I can't share my story without sharing about that. And so statistics tell us that 1 in 3 women will have had an abortion by the age of 45. And within the church, that's not any different. In fact, it might even be higher, because when somebody ends up in a crisis pregnancy, we're not really known to be the most supportive. I know I wasn't, and I grew up in a church, but I only learned that little portion of that. I didn't learn how to embrace somebody and to walk through that with them. And so maybe you're here and that's your story, that you have had an abortion. If you haven't realized that God loves you and He forgives you for that, that is what my hope is, that you will learn that and that you will be able to walk in forgiveness and healing with Him. But maybe you've already gone through that and you want to use that to share with other people and to be able to walk through that with them. And I'd love to talk to you if you do, because we need to be able to do that. We need more people willing to do that. And so God's love is no different for anybody based on their decision. And so if God's love is the same, how do we engage with other people? What about the power of our words? Do we know what the power and weight of our words holds? Do we grow in the fruit of the Spirit? And are we intentional with how we serve and uplift others? In Proverbs, I was reading Proverbs 8 and 9, and this really hit me. Proverbs 8, 19 reads, "My fruit is better than fine gold. What I yield surpasses choice silver." And as I read that, first thing that popped to mind was fruit, a pear, an apple, my fruit. And I thought, no, you know, I don't think that's really what he's talking about. He's probably talking about the fruit of the Spirit. So then I flipped to Galatians, and I just wanted to share this with you to think about. I flipped too far. In Galatians 5 talks about the fruit of the Spirit. And it says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. So are we living with Christ? How we engage with him? Are we allowing him to use us to share the fruit of the Spirit with others? So how we engage with him, like what Sherry was talking about, will pour into how we engage with others. And how closely we know him is how closely we can share his goodness with others and the fruits of his Spirit. So that's just what I wanted to leave you with, is to think about that. I know Jackie actually typed up some really great discussion questions, but the fruit of the Spirit really hit me, because I'm not quite sure that I always walk in patience and kindness, but I should. And so thank you for letting me share part of my story. Appreciate it.